So, hello guys, today biology, we are looking at what we call digestion. Now digestion, we are going to look at mainly digestion in human beings. Now remember, as you will discover that digestion as a process is very, very important in our bodies. We know properly, we always eat food, like we always take the potato pieces, the cassava pieces, the pieces of meat, we take the milk. Now all of these foods always exist in a complex form, or in complicated forms. So it is this process of digestion that can break down the complex food substances into simpler food substances which our cells need. So this is one of the processes which is important in the body, and there is no way how we can live happily without doing what we call digestion. We can only get all the food values from the food we eat, that is by breaking the food substances. So our biology today is that. So try to follow me up and then you discover how digestion is important. Simplify the biology, we can begin by talking about the definition of digestion. We can begin by talking about the definition of digestion. So digestion can be simplified by saying that this is a process by which complex food substances are broken down into simpler food substances that can be absorbed into the blood, what? The bloodstream. Remember, now we are looking at food entering our blood. Now the gastrointestinal tract or the alimentary canal. A canal in biology means an opening. You'll discover that you have an opening which is the mouth, and you have an opening which you are calling the anus. In simple terms, the food enters through the opening known as the mouth, and then it leaves into another opening known as the anus. So that tube from the mouth to the point of the anal canal or the anus is what we are calling the alimentary canal. Members, you'll discover that some of the components of the alimentary canal or the gastrointestinal tract, or what you call the digestive system, is mainly made up of the following. We have the mouth, we have the pharynx, then we have the esophagus, then we have the stomach, the small intestines, the large intestines, and then the anal canal. On the same system, we have organs which are biologically important. These organs are also helping in digestion. Actually, these organs in biology, we can clearly categorize them as accessory what? Organs, even though the books will put them on alimentary what? Canal. These accessory organs include what we are calling the teeth, the tongue, then the salivary glands, then the liver, the gallbladder, and the pancreas. So try to note the teeth, the tongue, the salivary glands, the liver, and then the gallbladder with the pancreas. These ones acting as accessory structures of it. The function of the buccal cavity, it is simply for ingestion and mastication of food substances. We are going to talk about ingestion as we are moving on. Then when you look at the pharynx, it is mainly important for swallowing. We are going to see that when you are swallowing, even breathing stops momentarily because of now this pharynx, which we are going to talk about. Then we are seeing that another component which is important is known as the esophagus. Members, the esophagus is simply the part which connects the pharynx to the stomach. That is the esophagus. It is connecting the pharynx to the stomach. In simple terms, it forms a continuous tube along which the food substances we have chewed pass to reach the stomach. Then the duodenum is simply concerned with the digestion and absorption of food substances. Remember also we have what we are calling the cardiac muscle on the same system. This cardiac muscle prevents regurgitation of food. Always eat food and moves downwards in the stomach. Now preventing that food from coming backward, that one is all over the cardiac muscle. Remember when that food is coming back, like as other ruminants are doing, chewing cud, there we say they are doing regurgitation. But if you overconsume food, always see that the cardiac muscles are going to contract and the food comes back in form of what? Vomiting. Then we have another structure there, which is called the liver. The liver is one of the biggest organs in the body. Actually, it's the biggest organ in the body, but its role here in digestion, it mainly secretes what we are calling bile. And this bile, you'll discover that in that brain part, and you sometimes when you break it down, the whole fish may become bitter. That is now the bile which I'm talking about, but located in the what? In the liver. Now this one secretes bile, and bile is for emulsification of fats, or breaking down the fats into small droplets. Now we are having also what we are calling the pancreas. Now this pancreas, what we are calling the pancreatic juice, which contains enzymes that are important for the digestion of starch, proteins, and fats. We are going to see those enzymes like pancreatic amylase, like trypsin. Others will be like lipase, olipase. So those are the main enzymes which are dominating in the pancreatic juice, and they are playing a role. We are going to talk about what we call an enzyme. Remember, an enzyme is a simple biological catalyst that now controls the breakdown of food substances in the body. It can control by increasing or by lowering, but in most cases, they are speeding up biochemical processes in the body. Then another part of the alimentary canal is what we are calling the ileum. The ileum is part where digestion of food substances are completed and later absorbed into the bloodstream. Then another part which cannot leave is what we are calling the colon. Now the colon is important for absorption of water. Then the rectum, this one is the formation. It is for formation and storage of the feces. Remember, we are going to look at what we call ejection. That is a process of passing out undigested food substances, but they are kept in the rectum. And once the rectum muscles contract, we see it passing via the anus. And this anus is mainly for ejection, passing out the undigested food substances. Members, as we are looking at the whole process of digestion, there are some terminologies which we have to appreciate. One of the terminology is known as ingestion. It's like when you are ingestion, you are going to discover like when you are eating food, you pick the food from the saucepan or from the plate into your mouth. That process of putting food into the mouth is what we are calling ingestion. So taking food, that you are ingesting food, that is ingestion. Then another process is what we are calling digestion. That one we have already simplified it. Members, that digestion is simply the process how complex food substances are broken down into simpler food substances that can be absorbed into the blood stream. Then you discover that we have what we call assimilation. Assimilation, putting food into use, that is assimilation. The process how the absorbed food substances are put into use. This is the utilization of the food. We have taken, for example, cassava, the starch in the cassava has been broken down into glucose. then the glucose has entered into the bloodstream. Now the glucose is going to be burnt or broken down by respiration, and then we shall see getting energy and water. That is assimilation. You have taken the proteins, meat, fish or eggs, and the body has broken down the proteins. We see that we are going to get what we call amino acids. These amino acids now are going to enter the bloodstream, and this one we are going now to help information of structures like our hair, our skin, our nerves, our enzymes themselves, plasma proteins like fibrinogen, and so on. So that you want to call it assimilation. Then another process we are calling it absorption. Absorption is simply the process how the digested food substances enter the bloodstream. Here today we're going to talk about members, what we are calling the villi or the villus. These ones are going to be located on the walls of the small intestines. Remember, digestion is ending in the small intestines. So after digestion has stopped, the food substances are not left there wasted. The food substances are going to move into the bloodstream via the walls of the villi. The body digesting or breaking down the food substances, not all the food substances are broken down. You see that there are some particles which are not broken down. Now the broken down ones are going to pass via the villus into the bloodstream. Now those ones, members which have not been broken down, cannot be left in the body to ferment, because when they ferment in the body, a problem will arise in your stomach or your alimentary canal. Therefore, God made a design. Remember, God is a supreme scientist. God made a design that these food substances which are now useless in the body, which are not broken down, are passed outwards via the anus. But remember, they are stored first in the rectum. Then afterwards, they are released via the anus. So the process of passing out undigested food substances is what we can call digestion. Now, members, let us try to look after grasping the terminologies which are important. Remember, teachers always ask you such terminologies. So follow up this video properly to create a good picture in your brain of what we are calling digestion. Now, members, let us begin by looking at digestion in the mouth. Digestion in the mouth, members, it is mainly mechanical digestion and chemical digestion. Mechanical digestion, we are going to see your food is being broken down by the teeth, what we are calling chewing or mastication. Then the chemical digestion, we are going to see enzymes like salivary amylase coming in. So we are seeing that the digestion in the mouth is mainly carried out by the action of the teeth. During chewing or mastication, and this is termed as what we are calling physical digestion or mechanical digestion. Members, chewing exposes the food to a much larger surface area, which enzymes can act because of the different adaptations of the teeth. Food is being chewed and broken down into smaller particles. When the food is broken down into smaller particles, members, at the same time, we have in the mouth what we are calling the salivary glands. The salivary glands are swellings at the back of our tongue there. As you are going to follow up the video, try to follow up that video properly. Now, because of the presence of salivary glands, we see production of saliva. The saliva contains water. Once the tongue mixes the saliva with the food, you always see that, first of all, the food softens, and secondly, the enzyme in the saliva known as tyrosine or salivary amylase mixes with the food. This enzyme breaks down the starch in the food into what we are calling the maltose. Then afterwards, in the mouth, we are seeing that the tongue rolls the food into balls. These balls are going to be pushed by the tongue sieve to the pharynx. The pharynx, and then it connects to the esophagus, and finally to the stomach. By saying in the mouth, we have chewing or mastication done by the teeth to increase the surface area of the food. At the same time, we have the tongue mixes the food with the saliva from the salivary glands. Then the enzyme tearing up salivary amylase in the mouth, after mixing with the food, it breaks down what we are calling the starch to maltose. Then we are seeing our tongue also rolling the food into boluses or small balls, which are pushed downwards, and then they are swallowed. Now we are seeing that in the process of swallowing there, the food moves by peristalsis through the esophagus. Peristalsis means contraction of the muscles of the walls. So you are seeing the food moves downward the stomach by the muscles of the gullet or the esophagus, squeezing it until it reaches what? Downwards. Esophagus is having that peristaltic movements. However, peristaltic movements can also be seen like in the oviduct, as we have seen in reproduction, even in the nasal cavity as the mucus is moving out. For example, when you have flu, then there we have what we are calling, we have what we call peristalsis. Now, the food has already reached our stomach. When the food reaches the stomach, now we are going to talk about the digestion in the stomach. So let's talk about digestion in the stomach. Digestion in the stomach will be started by or triggered by presence of food in the stomach. Presence of food in the stomach stimulates the stomach walls to produce the hormone known as gastrin. The hormone gastrin, which has been secreted, this one now stimulates the gastric walls or the gastric glands to release what we are calling the gastric juice. The gastric juice, remember, contains the following. The gastric juice 1 contains an enzyme known as pepsin. Remember, pepsin is produced in its inactive form to prevent the eating or the breakdown of the stomach, since it is acting on proteins. So it is produced in active form known as pepsinogen. Now we are seeing our pepsin breaking down the proteins into peptides. Then the second components of our gastric juice, we have what called the renin. This renin is more concentrated in young people, and it is mainly important for coagulation of milk protein casein, which is then attacked by an enzyme known as pepsin, breaking it down to peptides. Now, the gastric juice, remember, the gastric juice also contains what we are calling mucus. This mucus prevents the stomach walls from the action of hydrochloric acid. That's our stomach is having hydrochloric acid. When you go back to chemistry, the teacher has told you that in our stomach we have hydrochloric acid. Which acid is important? However, if it is there without food, it can burn the walls of the stomach, and you get the wounds. Those wounds in Latin, they are calling them ulcers. So if the ulcer, the wounds are there, you get what you call the stomach ulcers or the gastric what? Ulcers. Now, the same gastric juices, members, contain what you call hydrochloric acid. The hydrochloric acid is having a lot of functions. However, we are saying it attacks and destroys the stomach walls, resulting into gastric what? Ulcers. That is if you don't eat in time or you don't have enough mucus. However, leaving that negative side, it is also having the advantages. One of the advantages, it lowers the pH to acidic pH, that is between 1.5 to 2, which is optimum for the pepsin to do its work best. Remember, in the mouth, we talked about pH, which is slightly alkaline, in which saliva amylase can act. As we are moving ahead, we are going to talk about that enzymes always work best in a certain pH of the medium. They don't just work anyhow in all pHs of the medium. Some are best in acidic medium, some are best in neutral medium, others are best in acidic medium. So you are seeing now hydrochloric acid lowering the pH. Remember, the food has come with the high pH. Now this acid creates acidic pH in which Pepsi can do the work best. The same hydrochloric acid also kills ingested bacteria, hence preventing food in the stomach from fermenting or going bad. So that food we are eating is having a lot of bacteria. The useful bacteria and the non-useful bacteria. Bacteria are very good in doing what you call decomposition or fermentation or decaying. So if the bacteria are left there, the food will ferment or decay very fast. So what happens, this HCl kills the bacteria and then the fermentation will not occur very fast. Remember that food also ferments in the body as it's moving along the canal. Then three, it dissolves mineral salts in the food. It stops the work of salivary amylase. Remember, salivary amylase is active in slightly alkaline medium. Now it reaches a zone which is acidic, which acidity has been created by HCl. So now here we are going to see that it is going to be denatured. And once it is denatured, no work continues again. So pepsinogen is converted into pepsin by what you call hydrochloric acid. Now, then also the mechanical breakdown of food occur in the what? In the stomach. This one is done by churning activity of the muscular walls of the what? Of the stomach. The stomach walls squeezes the food. As they are squeezing the food softens into a paste. So when we are talking about the stomach digestion now, members, we are going to wrap up by saying, you talk about presence of the food in the stomach stimulates the release of gastrin. Release of gastrin stimulates the gastric glands in the gastric walls to release gastric juice. The gastric juice contains one, the hydrochloric acid. This acid activates the pepsinogen, the gastric juice into pepsin. Then the pepsin breaks down the available proteins into peptides. At the same time, we are seeing that if the food contains milk, the enzyme renin in the gastric juice coagulates the milk protein, casein, such that it is in solid state. And then from there, we are seeing the pepsin attacking the protein in the milk. Then the mucus is there, which is preventing now damaging of the gastric walls. So digestion of starch, we don't see it in the stomach. Take note of that. We don't see digestion of the starch in the stomach. Why? You have discovered already that we don't have the enzyme to break down the food. The one which is there has been denatured. Now let us talk about digestion in the duodenum.